Greetings in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I hope many of you or all of you participated in our midweek prayer and fasting. Personally, I look forward to spending time with the Lord. And I hope you had a good time spending time with the Lord. And lastly, before I go to our topic today, I'm encouraging all of you, inviting all of you to continue the habit of prayer and fasting every Friday. The entire CCF, the leadership team, the staff, we fast every Friday lunchtime. Hope to see you next Friday. We continue our series on end game. What do we mean by end game? What's going to happen at the end? This is what's going to happen. Jesus is coming. Be ready. Today we will discuss Matthew chapter 24. It is about Jesus and what he has to say about end times. You see, the disciple asked Jesus, point blank, when are these things going to happen? When are you coming back? And what are the signs? So these are specific questions. And I'm so glad Jesus taught them. Matthew 24, verses 1 and 2. Jesus came out from the temple and was going away when his disciples came up and pointed out the temple building. And he said to them, do you not see all these things? And then he made the amazing statement. This is what he said. Truly, I say to you, not one stone here will be left upon another, which will not be torn down. Why is it an incredible statement? Many people don't realize Herod started the work for the renovation of the temple in 19 BC, before Christ. And that work continued on. It was finally completed in 63 AD. Imagine, after spending all that money to remodel, to rebuild, to improve the temple, here is now Jesus saying, not one stone will be left on the temple. That is the prophecy. Not one stone. Why is that so important? Because history tells us that when the Roman government got so angry with the Jewish people, they sent this general, General Titus, to take over Jerusalem because Jerusalem was rebellious. The people were rebelling. And the Roman government was so angry that the people who tried to hide inside the temple because of its sacredness, they were thinking they'll be spared, but not the Roman soldiers. They were so angry. They killed almost over a million Jews. Not only that, the temple got burned. So what? Well, do you realize the temple's motif, the roof, the decking, were made of gold? And when the gold melted, it went to the crevices of the temple stones. Now, the temple stones are not like hollow blocks. Some of them are as long as 50 feet, as wide as 24 feet. So these are massive stones. Why will Jesus say they will fall down? Precisely because of the gold. They wanted to recover the gold that got melted, that went inside those crevices. Friends, one thing I want you to know, when Jesus says something, it will surely happen. And that is the backdrop of this prophecy. The certainty of the destruction of that temple. That temple was a masterpiece. It was so beautiful. And that temple was destroyed. Many of them saw it with their own eyes. The people listening realized when Jesus says something, it will happen. With that as the background, Jesus now tells them, He was sitting on the Mount of Olives. The disciples came to him privately, saying, "Tell us, when will these things happen? What will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age?" Do you know these are questions? Three questions. When will these things happen? The destruction of the temple. Next, what will be the sign of your coming? You see, the coming of Jesus is so important that he taught them that he's coming again. That's why they asked Jesus, "What is the sign of your coming?" And then they asked, "And what are the signs of the end of the age?" When is the end of the age? That word "end" is from the word teleos. What is the end game? What is the final conclusion? Why is the second coming so important? Why are we discussing it today? Does it matter? Will it make a difference in your life if you believe Jesus is coming again or you don't believe he's coming again? Will that impact your life? I guarantee you, it makes all the difference. And you will know why as we go through what Jesus is telling the disciples. Jesus talked about his second coming and he wanted them to be protected. So the first P is for their protection. You need to know the truth. The second is for them to be prepared. It is important that they be prepared. Why should we talk about the second coming? Because Jesus wants us to persevere. And that is what he wanted to convey to his disciples. So let's look at these three. So what do we mean by protection? In Matthew 24, verses 3 onward, Jesus tells them, "See to it that no one misleads you. For many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and will mislead many." Do you notice that word? See to it that no one will mislead you. Jesus wanted to protect the disciples. Jesus is warning them, don't let anyone mislead you when they say, "I am the Christ." Today, many people believe that a certain person is the Messiah, is the Savior. That is dangerous because you are risking your entire future in believing something that's wrong. So it is important to know prophecy to protect us. Jesus tells them, you'll be hearing of wars, rumors of wars. See that you are not frightened. You see, Jesus wants to protect us. You don't have to be afraid, but I want you to know the truth. He says, these things must take place, but that is not yet the end. Nation will rise against nation, kingdoms against kingdom, various places, there will be famines, earthquakes, but all these things are merely the beginning of birth pangs. Now, those of you who are mothers, those of you who are fathers, you understand what is the meaning of birth pangs. My wife was a mother of 5 children. And before each child were to be born, we noticed something. Her stomach will begin to contract. It's called birth pangs. The closer the intervals, the stronger the intensity of the contraction, you know the baby is going to come soon. And that is what Jesus is saying. In short, Jesus is saying, when you see these things, it is not yet the end, but the end is nearer than you think. And I began to research on those signs, wars, rumors of wars. You'll be amazed. We thought that after the end of Second World War, after the establishment of the United Nations, you'll have less wars. On the contrary, what Jesus is saying is so true. Today, you have more wars. Nations against nations. That word nation is ethnos. It's ethnic groups. It is not a political division. It is like Muslim in the Philippines against Christians in the Philippines. It's ethnic groups. It's like what's happening in Africa. One tribe against another tribe. It's like what's happening in Iraq, what's happening in the Middle East. One tribe against another tribe. The Bible tells us wars and rumors of wars, they will increase. And then the Bible talks about famines. You will think famines is a thing of the past. No, in the 21st century alone, you have the famine in Congo, 5.4 million people died, the famine in Sudan, the famine in Uganda, the famine in Somalia. You may not realize, as of today, every day, you have 25,000 people dying from hunger. And out of those 25,000, you have 10,000 children dying daily. If I were to compute that on an annual basis, you have 9 million people dying of hunger today, every year. And you have over 3.5 million children dying every year. We have not solved the problem of famine. Jesus prophesied, there will be plagues. Now, you and I will be thinking, with the advancement of science, we should overcome pandemics, epidemics. But let's look at history. Some of the worst pandemics that has happened, it's called the Black Death, the bubonic plague spread by rats. Around 200 million people died, almost 51% of the population of Europe. New World smallpox, wow, 12% of the population. Spanish flu, this is just in the 20th century, and that's why you have the quarantine. It's because of the Spanish flu. They wanted to quarantine people, cuarto, 40, quarantine. 50 million died. And of course, you have the HIV. HIV is still ongoing, and you have already 35 million people who have died, and today you have the COVID-19 pandemic. My whole point is this, nothing new under the sun. There will be pandemics. What is very striking to me is earthquakes. The Bible tells us in the end time, there will be earthquakes. If I show you a chart of what's happening when it comes to big earthquakes, over 5, magnitude of 5, look at what's happening. In the 1900s, that's the chart. Every 10 years, you will notice from the 1900s up to 2000, the year 2000 now, look at the graph. The earthquake is increasing. It's increasing exponentially. Can I tell you what God is saying? God is shaking the world. God is telling us, be ready. I'm coming soon. I will tell you the signs. And earthquake is one of those signs. God wants also to prepare us. What do I mean? To be forewarned is to be forearmed. And he tells us in the next few verses, Matthew 24, let me read. Then they will deliver you to tribulation. They will kill you. You will be hated by all nations because of my name. Brothers, sisters in Christ, do not be under an illusion that the world will fall in love with believers. The truth is this. God tells his disciples, you will be hated by all nations because of my name. Today, you will see Christians are being attacked all over the world. What is very sad, even in the States today, they're attacking Christianity. At that time, many will fall away and will betray one another and hate one another. You notice? Today you have Christians betraying other Christians. Look at verse 11. Many false prophets will arise and will mislead many. Jesus warns us, there will be many false prophets. Why is this important? You need to be prepared. You need to be protected from false prophets. What do I mean, false prophets? In the time of Moses, people asked Moses, how will we know who is a counterfeit prophet and who is a true prophet? Because today there are many people claiming to be prophets. I'm sure you have heard many, many church leaders claiming that this guy is a prophet. This is what he said. Well, I want you to be careful. Based on the Bible, how do you tell who are real prophets, who are not? Let's find out. Deuteronomy 18, 20 to 22. But the prophet who speaks a word presumptuously in my name which I have not commanded him to speak, that prophet shall die. The moment a prophet begins to claim, this is what God is saying, and it does not happen, the Bible says that person should die because he is being presumptuous, claiming to be a messenger of God, but he's delivering his own message. You may say in your heart, how will we know the word which the Lord has not spoken? How can we tell? Today I tell people, it is important you must know the word of God, because the word of God and the word of a real prophet will never contradict. But notice, when a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the thing does not come about or come true, that the thing which the Lord has not spoken, the prophet has spoken presumptuously, you shall not be afraid of him. In short, don't listen to him. In other words, God wants us to be discerning, to be careful. But this is one of those warnings that I want all believers to be prepared. This warning is more serious than earthquakes, famine, epidemics. What is this? Lawlessness is increased, most people's love will grow cold. And this is what's happening today. It's unbelievable. If you're watching the news, even you watch what's happening in America, lawlessness is increasing. But the danger is not just lawlessness. The danger is this. Because lawlessness is increased, most people's love will grow cold. That includes Christians. Friends, Jesus wants you to be prepared. He wants you to be protected. The danger of a cold heart is more serious than pandemics. What do I mean? The moment you lose your love for God, what will you be doing? Everything you are doing will be legalism. The moment a pastor loses his love for the Lord, the moment a D group leader loses his love for the Lord, what kind of ministry will that be? It will just be like a routine. You will be doing something out of habit, but it's no longer love. And that, my friend, is very dangerous. And God warns us, in the end time, the heart of the people will grow cold. Let us always hear the warning of Jesus. Your love for God, your love for one another must be maintained. That is how you can persevere. And that's how you can be protected. The reality is, Jesus warns you, he warns me, for the reality of hardship, persecutions. Based on the Open Doors latest research, 2018-2019, every day you have 13 Christians killed. Every day you have 12 churches, 12 church buildings being attacked. And every day you have around 12 Christians arrested, detained. What is very sad is in the 21st century, it is not possible to practice religion or belief safely in many parts of the world. And that's exactly what Jesus said. In the end times, you will have attack. You will be persecuted. He not only wants to protect them, he wanted them to be prepared, but more than that, he wanted them to persevere. What do we mean by persevere? Persevere is from the word endures. Let's read this. The one who endures to the end, he will be saved. What does it mean, endures to the end? You see, the Bible tells us, if you are a true follower of Jesus, you will not only believe, you will continue believing. To continue believing means what? You will endure, you will persevere, you will keep on doing what is right. That word, persevere, comes from the word hupomeno. Do you remember hupomeno? That's the word for to remain under a burden. But it also means you are not just under the burden, but you have a positive attitude. You are bearing the burden with the strength of the Lord. That's the idea of persevering. You endure. It's one thing to be faithful for one day. It's one thing to be faithful for 1 week. It's another thing to be faithful for 1 year. But it is altogether another thing to be faithful for 10 years. To be faithful for the rest of your life. My question, are you learning to persevere? To keep on doing what God wants you to do, not just for 1 day, 1 week, 1 year, 2 years. My goodness, if it takes a lifetime, are you willing to persevere to the end of your life? That's what God wants us to learn. What must we continue doing? This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all the nations, and then the end will come. Here is a very clear answer. When the end will happen? The end will come, the Bible tells us, the gospel of the kingdom, the gospel of Jesus, wow, shall be preached to the whole world. And then the end will come. What does it mean to endure? You not only keep on believing, you keep on preaching the gospel. You keep on doing what He has commanded us to do. That is what Jesus told the disciples. In 2006, there were a group of Christian leaders who met together. They realized there are over 3,000 unreached people group. What do we mean by unreached people group? These are people who don't have any local church in that community. There's nobody planning to evangelize them. No gospel. That's the same idea of ethnos, particular ethnic groups. In the Philippines, for you to understand what are people groups, people from Ifugao, people in Palawan. Now in Palawan, you have Tagbanwa. You have different tribes. Each tribe is a people group. You have Mangyans. Technically, you will notice that the gospel has been proclaimed to the whole world. It began in the Middle East. It went to Europe, and then it went to America. And from America, it went to South America, to Africa, to Asia. And now the gospel is being proclaimed back to the Middle East. God's desire is for the whole world to know Him and to repent. God has done His part. He wants us to do our part. Therefore, it is important that you and I do our part. Let's share the gospel. Let's get involved in whatever methods that can share the gospel with other people. I suggest go viral. It's very effective. It's very simple. If you want to know more about Go Viral, let us know. You can click on the CCF website about Go Viral, a simple way of sharing the gospel. In 2005, you have around 3,500 unreached people groups. But because a group of leaders met together, how to strategize to reach this unreached group? As of today, I have good news for you. As of today, of 2021, there are only around 500 unreached people group. CCF is part of this movement. We are sending missionaries to places where they have never been reached. And by the grace of God, would you believe it? Many of them are using Go Viral. Are you doing something to share the gospel so that everybody will have a chance to hear? And the truth is this, Christianity is growing. The truth is this, there are more believers alive today than there ever was in the time of Christ, up to this century. You have more people who are alive today who are Christians. Why? Because many of God's people are spreading the good news. And I praise God for you. I praise God for CCF Beyond. We are reaching to the far corners of the world. We are planting churches to people group, to those we have never heard. And I pray we will do the same. How do you persevere? He tells us there will be a great tribulation, such as not occurred since the beginning of the world until now. He talks about a great tribulation that has not occurred in the past until now, nor ever will. So what is he talking about? He's talking about the great tribulation. Verse 22, unless those days had been cut short, no life would have been saved. But for the sake of the elect, those days will be cut short. If anyone says to you, here is Christ, or there he is, do not believe him. In short, what is Jesus saying? There will be a day of great, great tribulation. And the elect, it will be going through those tribulations. In the time of great tribulation, you will not have false Christ, and false prophets will arise. And they will show great signs and wonders as to mislead, if possible, even the elect. Behold, I told you in advance. You know what Jesus is saying? Even the elect, even the believers, if they are not prepared, if they are not warned, they can be deceived. You know why? The false prophets and the false Christ will say, in the midst of this tribulation, I am your Savior. I will save that day. That's the meaning of the word Antichrist, substitute for the Messiah. And he continues, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. This must be so scary. When the power of heavens will be shaken, I cannot imagine such a day. If you see that movie, Deep Impact, where the meteors, a big meteor is going to fall on the earth, stars are falling, that's the idea. And then look at verse 30. And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. But you notice something? As he's coming, what will happen? All the tribes of the earth will mourn. Why will they mourn? Because, again, many have rejected Jesus. They didn't realize he is the Messiah. He's the Savior. When he comes, you will see the sadness, the regrets of their lives. But what is amazing is the next verse. And he will send his angels with a great trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the sky to the other. Elect. You have that word elect repeated again and again and again. What is the meaning of the word elect? The word elect comes from this Greek word ekletos. That is always applied to God's people. That's where you have the word chosen. In fact, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 tells us, you are a chosen race. You are an elect. That's where you have the word chosen, selected. It always refers to God's people. In other words, it is very possible. If you read Matthew 24, especially verse 22, unless those days have been cut short, no life would have been saved, but for the sake of the elect, for our sake. That means there are believers who will go through the tribulation. In verse 24, if possible, even the elect will be misled. Believers can be misled. And Matthew 24, verse 31, the angels will gather his elect. So what does that mean? This is where I like you to understand biblical theology. When the Bible is very clear on something, you can teach it dogmatically. But when it comes to the second coming of Christ, when it comes to the rapture, my friend, don't be dogmatic as to the when. You can be sure of this. Jesus is coming again. You see, the whole message today is very simple. Jesus is coming very soon. Be ready. He gave 7 illustrations in Matthew 24 to 25. What are the 7 illustrations? He talks about the fig tree. He talks about Noah. He talks about the 2 workers. He talks about the thief. He talks about the servants. This is Matthew chapter 24. I don't have time to expand on the 10 virgins and the talents, which is in Matthew 25. But if you study all of these, they have one common theme. You do not know when Jesus is coming again, but you must be ready. Let's talk about the illustration of the fig tree. Jesus tells us, learn from the parable of the fig tree. When you see the branch becoming tender and bring forth leaves, you know the summer is near. You too, when you see all these things, recognize He is near, right at the door. What Jesus is saying is simply this. Fig trees are known in Israel. During winter, they lose all their leaves. However, when springtime comes, you will see the buds, the leaves, slowly blooming. And Jesus is saying, when you see a fig tree with leaves, you know the summer is near. With that story, He's saying, you better realize, when you see all of these signs, wars, rumors of wars, remember, I'm coming very soon. Look at His expression. Recognize that He is near, right at the door. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. What do you mean by this generation? Many scholars like to believe the generation that sees what's happening, that is seeing all of these signs. For some people, they see the fig tree represent Israel. When you see Israel restored as a nation, that generation will see all of these things happening. Well, whatever it is, this is what is important. In verse 35, Jesus said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. I want you to notice, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. What Jesus is saying is this. This is a certainty. What I say will come true. I am coming again. All of these prophecies will happen. My word is even more dependable than the heavens or the earth. The rising of the sun, the setting of the sun, the planet earth that you see. My word will last. My word will come true. Verse 36. Notice the repetition. On that day and hour, no one knows. You will not know when. Not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father alone. Do you know what Jesus is saying? Nobody knows when I'm coming. Not even the angels. Not even the Son. But the Father alone. Now you may ask, how come Jesus does not know? Remember, Jesus is 100% man, 100% God. At this point in life, He chooses to inhibit His divinity. And that's why Jesus could die. Even though He was God, He was Son, but He surrendered the rights of being God. So when Jesus talks about no one knows the second coming, not even the angels, but God alone. In short, be careful when people start telling you, I am sure Jesus is coming next year. Don't ever believe them. Because Jesus says, nobody will know. You know it is near, but you don't know exactly when. And then He gives the example. The coming of the Son of Man will be like the days of Noah. As those days before the flood, they were what? Eating, drinking, marrying, and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark. Jesus is not saying it is wrong to eat, it is wrong to drink, it is wrong to get married. What Jesus is simply saying is this. The people went through their regular routine, but they did not care or bothered to take the warning of Noah seriously. They did not understand until the flood came and took them all away, so will the coming of the Son of Man be. You know the lesson for you and for me? Don't be like those people in the time of Noah. They are so careless. They did not want to bother to ask. What is the implication of the message of God? You must understand, Noah warned them. The Bible tells us Noah preached to these people. Can you imagine when Noah was building the ark, people saw Noah building the ark. Did they bother to ask him, why are you building the ark? Noah, I'm sure, will tell them, because God told me there's going to be rain and there's going to be flood, and I want to be prepared. Now, those people, you must know, they don't understand rain, they don't understand the flood, but all they know is, here's this guy building like a boat to protect his family. They didn't bother. When they saw the animals entering the ark, did they ask Noah, Noah, why are all the animals entering the ark? You see, my friend, don't be so preoccupied with your routinary activities that you neglect the warnings of the Lord. He's coming soon. He wants you and me to be ready. And the Bible tells us when the flood came, that's the time they realized what Noah was talking about. But it was too late. You see, there's a point in your life when God gives you opportunities. Don't be so busy with whatever you are doing that you neglect the warnings of God. Then he gave the example of two men working in the field. One will be taken, one will be left. He talks about two women working, grinding the meal. One will be taken, one will be left. But notice the most important thing about that example. Verse 42. Therefore, be on the alert. You do not know the day your Lord is coming. Do you notice the emphasis? You don't know the day. Be alert. And then he gave another example of the thief. If the head of the house had known at what time the night the thief was coming, he would have been on the alert. The focus is be alert, because you do not know when the thief will break in. Verse 44, for this reason, you must be ready. Notice the emphasis, be ready, be ready. Why? The Son of Man is coming at an hour when you do not think he will. Do you notice the emphasis of the entire chapter, Matthew 24? You do not know when. He's coming very soon. Be ready, be alert. What does it mean to be ready? He talks about a slave, a servant, and the master. Who then is the faithful and sensible slave whom his master put in charge of his household to give them their food at the proper time? Notice how he described the slave. Who is the faithful and sensible slave? What is the meaning of the word sensible? It is a very important word. It's from the word phronimos. The word phronimos has the idea of your inner thought life, your perspective, impacting your behavior. That's the word for sensible. When somebody is sensible, you know he's thinking right and he's acting right. Who then is the faithful and sensible slave? Notice, the sensible slave, the one with the right perspective, the one with the right attitude, the one with the right belief system. Look at verse 46. Blessed is that slave whom his master finds so doing when he comes. The word blessed means what? Happy. You should be happy. Why? Verse 47. Truly I say to you, he will put him in charge of all of his possessions. Here is the amazing promise. If you know Jesus is coming, you will be protected from laziness. You will not only be protected, you will prepare. You will be faithful. You will persevere. And then the result will be, you hear him say, well done, I will put you in charge of all his possessions. In other words, does it matter today whether you believe Jesus is coming or not? Yes, it matters. It affects your life. It affects your future. It affects other people. Look at the next verse, the contrast. But if that evil slave says in his heart, my master is not coming for a long time, and begins to beat his fellow slaves and eat and drink with drunkards, the master of that slave will come on a day when he does not expect him at an hour which he does not know. And he will cut him into pieces, assign him in a place with the hypocrites. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This expression was used by Jesus 7 times in the New Testament. And every time this phrase is used, weeping and gnashing of teeth, it is bad news. Regrets, remorse, horrible condition. Friends, this message is crucial. It will impact your eternity. Are you ready or are you not ready? There is no middle ground. My prayer is you will be ready. To be ready is not just to know. It is to do something about it. Like in the days of Noah, people knew, people heard, but they did not do anything. Why? Perhaps they don't really believe that the rain is coming, that the flood is coming. They were not prepared. And the Bible tells us when the flood came, it was too late. The same thing when it comes to the servant. The servant knew that the master is coming, but the servant does not know when. What's the difference? The one that is sensible, I want you to know that word, faithful and sensible, did something. He was faithful every day. We do not know how long. But if you study the parable of Matthew chapter 25, the virgins and the 5 talents, the principle is to be ready, is to persevere, to be faithful, not just 1 day, 2 days, to persevere. I'm reminded of my mistake years ago about perseverance. You see, my father would tell us to clean up our mess, to clean up our room. My father will inspect from time to time. And I realize I've been fixing up my room, but my father has not come to inspect. Would you believe it? The day I decided not to clean up my mess was the day he came. And that is very clear in my mind. I was so embarrassed. I felt so sad that my father came on the day when I did not fix up my room. That, my friend, is the meaning of sensible and being faithful. You be faithful daily. Because when Jesus comes, will he see you faithful? When Jesus comes again, what are you doing? A faithful person will keep on doing what God wants him to do. I'm reminded of what happened to Pompeii when the volcano erupted and many people died on the spot. They did not have to die because weeks before the eruption, you have signs. The volcano was giving up smoke. There were earthquakes. And yet, only a few took heed and they did something. The Bible tells us today you hear rumors of war. You have tremors. All of these signs, it's happening. What's happening to Israel? Lawlessness is increased. People's hearts are no longer with the Lord. You have all of these signs. But many people will know in the head but do nothing about it. I want you to do something about it. I want you to get your life right with the Lord. If you have not accepted Him as your Lord and Savior today, make sure you come to Him. Surrender your life to Him. To those of you who know Him, but you have somehow lost the perseverance, you have somehow gone astray, you are no longer being faithful, you are not doing what He wants you to do, my friend, it's never too late to repent. Because the heart of God is you must be ready. I am coming soon. when that is not the issue. But be ready. That is the issue. Are you ready? To be ready means what? Take actions. Take Jesus seriously. He's the coming King. He's the coming Judge. And all of us will give an account of our lives. To those who are faithful, it will be a time of great joy, great celebration. And that's my prayer. That when I see Jesus, I'll be full of joy. The truth is this. That is the most important day of your life and my life. Everything I have done, everything I will do, I look forward to that day when I see my Savior and my Master, and then when I see Him smile and say, well done. And that, my friend, is only possible if you and I be ready all the time. Why don't you ask God today, Lord, what do you want me to do that I'm not doing? Why don't you ask, Lord, what do you want me to stop doing? What relationship do you want me to give up? Lord, what do you really want me to be doing so that I will be ready to meet you at any moment? I will pray for you. Lord Jesus, I pray for many people today who have never taken this warning seriously. They are playing games. Forgive us, Lord, when we play games with you. Help us to take this seriously. Lord, we accept you, not just our Savior, but as our Master. You are the coming King. You are the coming Judge. Help us to take this warning seriously and help us to take this promise happily, for you will bring justice and rewards for your people. It should be a time of celebration, not a time of fear. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you have been blessed, we like to hear from you. Kindly click on the space provided below or visit our chat room. And I'd like you to participate in our discussion questions. But first, there will be a fast track. Let's listen.
Good day, CCF family. We are here with Pastor Peter Tanchi for our CCF Sunday Fast Track. And here are some of our questions. Pastor Peter, thank you for this message. This has been so good to be reminded of the coming of the end times. Yeah, we've been talking about the birth pangs, the wars, rumors of wars, famine. How can those things actually point out to a good and loving God if we know that those things are actually negative things?
If God wants to warn us, do you know of any other better way? Many times, pain causes us to look up. I really believe God is shaking this world to wake us up, to tell us time is near. Shape up, repent, I love you.
And speaking of love, you've also mentioned about sometimes we grow cold when it comes to our love for the Lord. And I think today, especially because of the pandemic, people are in isolation, in quarantine. Some of us are away from our families. We also have our OFW friends who are probably away from the church or away from their families. And they too have their personal struggles. What is your encouragement for people to actually continue when it comes to their love for God, despite of all the challenges that they're going through?
It is important that we be motivated, not just now, but the reality that someday, when He comes again, He will make a difference. The truth is there are some of us who are suffering. You have been praying, and somehow God has not answered your prayer requests. For some people, they've been hurting. They're living with family members who are unloving. The tendency is to feel like giving up. But when you focus on the reality that Jesus is coming soon. And whatever you do, you are doing it for Him. It gives you another kind of motivation. And how much more if you know you'll be rewarded accordingly. I really believe sometimes we don't think enough of the real reward. It's good to focus on love. But God is saying, I love you. That's why I want to reward you.
Yeah, that's so beautiful. Speaking of false prophets and false teachings, with the advent of internet today, our young people and even the older ones can actually just easily access information, preaching, reading materials so easily. How can we warn our young people when it comes to false teachings that are just so rampant all over the world?
Very good question. The only way you can tell false teaching from true teaching is to know the truth. And the way to know the truth is to know the Bible. There's no substitute for in-depth Bible study, for regular reading and study of scriptures. In CCF, you notice, we focus on Bible study, Bible reading. But above all, we want people to finish the Bible once a year. So when anybody will say anything against the Bible, your antenna goes up.
Since we don't know exactly where the second coming of Jesus will take place, how does that look practically on a day-to-day basis? How does waiting for Jesus practically look like?
It's a very practical, good question. I can only share from my own experience. I recommend you and I take time to meditate. Our problem is we don't take time to meditate. Example, recently, I took time to just think, Jesus, if you were to come today, how will it be? You see, I spent time thinking of the reality of what will happen when He comes again. And I tell you, it is life-changing. And that's why when you have quiet time, you should remind yourself, Jesus, if you are to come today, and then you think, Jesus is coming today, what will I do differently? Our problem today, we are so busy with activities. We don't think. When the Bible says, be sensible, you have to allow the heart belief to impact behavior. So that is very crucial, to meditate on the truth and then think through the implications.
Thank you very much for answering our questions. Thank you very much, everyone. That is CCF Sunday Fast Track, and we'll see you again next week.
I pray that you will discuss the following questions in your family, among your small groups, with your friends. Question number one, what must I do differently to be ready for the coming of Jesus? How can you keep fervent in your love for the Lord? And lastly, how can you be protected from false teachings and false prophets? God bless.
Thanks for watching. We would like to invite you to be a Christ-committed follower by being part of the movement as we honor God and obey His great commission. To find out if there's a CCF satellite near you, log on to www.ccf.org.ph/satellites. We also want to encourage you to join a small discipleship group where you can deepen your knowledge and love for Jesus and others. To sign up, log on to www.ccf.org.ph/discipleship group. All of CCF's video resources are available free of charge and are constantly being improved by our team. Would you consider supporting CCF through prayer and giving so more people can be blessed? You can give securely through our website at www.ccf.org.ph/give. For more videos like this, please subscribe to our channel. Thanks, and God bless.